old. There's blown up, those of you who haven't been in there yet, blown up photos of myself as a baby and a bar mitzvah picture. Yes. And Lee Van Oker said that I kind of, in a nice way, he said I passed the double ugly test at my bar mitzvah. You know, I look at it and I say, gee, to take a little photograph and blow it up and put it in a frame, and then there's a cake there. And I thought to myself, well, you know, that's my wife. She's given me a surprise gathering on my 30th birthday, my 40th birthday, my 50th birthday, my 60th birthday, and now she's eager and not wanting to wait until my 80th birthday. But we have a bunch of helpers who also got in on this, on the surprise, and it blessed my heart. So thank you, all those of you who did that. And what it reflects is a desire. I mean, you can see that's a desire on my wife's part to make her husband happy. But you know, there's also the desire of the other people. Patty and Michelle and Noelia, yeah, and you know, it's like helping out. It's like people are eager to find a way, you know, to make the Lord happy. And these things of putting ourselves out on His behalf make Him happy. Just like my wife taking the time makes me happy. We are the betrothed. We are the bride. It works the same way, identically the same way. So I want to applaud, and I want us all to applaud, because it is a testimony to the Lord. And personally appreciate it as well. Can I ask the children to come forward? Yeah, and also we have a nursery. I don't know if we, yeah. And Judy is not here. Do we have nursery people as well? Yes. And Gary Solomon is going to be our nursery teacher, since his bride is not with us this morning. Okay. Stan, Bill, why don't you come forward? Okay. All right. Bill, if you'll talk to God about the class. He's watching, and he's teaching.
Good morning, Holy Spirit. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for Carol and for her dedication and her commitment to teach your word to these children. We ask you to bless and guide her as she prepares her lesson material for the kids. We also pray that through her teaching, spiritual seeds will form and fall on good ground to produce a harvest that is acceptable to you and to your glory. In Yeshua's name we pray, amen.
Amen. Okay, children. All right. So it's 75 going on 100, you know, a number of years ago, I just had a growing sense of awareness that part of the blessing, that when I put the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost and lintel of my heart, that blessing was going to be for long life and good health in a and a bunch of other things too. And so far, so good. That's part of the blessing. Not only for me, but if we've got the blood of the Lamb, There is no reason not to expect blessing. No reason not to expect blessing. We stay with him, and he's looking and watching after us. So with regard to this business about long life and good health, let's see. I see Angel and Maricela back there. Raise your hands. Come on, real high, Maricela. Okay, that's real. Not okay. Now, you know, they're here with us most weeks. I don't know whether you realize it, but Angel's had a very unusual condition. We've had some very remarkable healings in the congregation. People who had termination dates and cancer and all kinds of tumors everywhere, but he's got his intestines totally loaded with it, to the point where now they're talking about the solution is to completely replace your intestines. Okay, now that's a big operation. That's only been done 5 times nationwide or worldwide. But they have decided that that's the solution for him. So he's going into the hospital for a month for tests and to have this operation done. And now, it goes one of two ways. I mean, either you're in full recovery because you got a new intestine, or you don't got no intestine and you don't need one. Because in Kingdom Come, they let you in without an intestine. Now, I'm guessing and standing in faith that what's going on here is there's this trial has been underway for years, and that because of the super-duper trial, that it is because it has caused Angel to have other reflections about life, changed his perspective. He will have a testimony. And because of all of that he's been through, it will give him great faith, greater faith than the most normal people, which suggests to me there's a ministry out there yet to be performed and awaiting the successful conclusion, the successful testimony, and a successful ministry. So we want to say that specially so that we can include that in our prayer this morning. We're going to pray that the Holy Spirit would speak to us about these matters and others. Please join me. Holy Spirit, you've said that when we would gather together in the name of our Messiah, that you would be in our midst. And that's why we come, because we come for your refreshment. All things seem better when we're involved with you, when you speak to us. We thank you for your word. You're the one that brought it into existence. It tells us of great promises and great things that are to come, and we rely upon you to keep us in good stead throughout our days. Help us in the ways that you do. Speak to us this morning out of your word that you established and preserved in Yeshua's name. Amen. The issue of good health is something that, you know, we're in this life. We all hope that we have good health. At different times, we have sometimes extended periods where we just say, you know, am I ever going to do better? Am I ever going to feel better? And it just seems like, is there a way out of this? Now, somehow, some way, sometimes through doctors, sometimes through the pharmacists, sometimes through surgery, sometimes through the laying on of hands. You know, my wife doesn't like me to say it, and this would be a bad day for me to to say the wrong thing. But I've maintained that she has healing hands. But when I ask her, you know, but if you ask her to pray with you, you know, she'll be very reluctant because she says, no, I don't have healing hands. My husband does. So we have this dispute between us. All I can tell you is when our son was 4 months old, he had a fever. It went from 104 to 106, and theoretically that starts to do brain damage. And it wasn't going down, and no matter what we did. So we put our hands on his head, and we prayed in our bedroom at night before we went to sleep because we didn't know what was going to be with our son. And we prayed for each of us with two hands on his head, and his temperature immediately returned to normal. My wife is a registered nurse. Doesn't it follow that she would have healing hands? So, but she's not the only one. You may have healing hands and not realize it. You know, the various shlichim, apostles. You know, it wasn't limited to Yeshua, the healing of people. They also could heal people. Huh? It's part of the blessing. We have to claim it. Sometimes, you know, there's a place in the scriptures that I hung on to for a year, and I had a supernatural healing. I couldn't breathe. I couldn't walk a city block, and I was 43 years old, and my life was over. My career was over, and it was very depressing. It was very disheartening, and I couldn't see, and where are you, God? And then I watched the 700 Club, and they read a testimony about this, that self same hour the woman began to amend. They quoted the scriptures, and I said, bingo, that's for me. Lord, I don't have faith for an immediate healing, but I can hang in there with that for a gradual healing. So all those of you who are saying, I want to be healed, I'm healed in the name of Yeshua, by his stripes I am healed, Lord, you know where I am, and if it takes until a year or 2 years, I have faith for a gradual healing. And if that's where you're at, that works too. Hallelujah. But it's part of the blessing. Okay, God works with each of us in interesting and miraculous ways. So I want to speak this morning about the issue of illness and healing. Primarily about healing. Because, you know, there's so much about illness, and there's so many explanations for it that some people say, well, it comes from previous generations. Some people say, well, this man was blind for the glory of God. This one for disobedience. There's different, all kinds of different explanations. But so it's kind of like it's very dangerous for us to guess, well, that one is sick because of this reason, or to speculate like that. We're probably wrong. You know, and why add to a person's burdens? Oh, my goodness, I'm stuck with this because of my previous generations. I'm stuck with this for out of some disobedience, but I don't know what. Let's not, you know, when we do that, we just put a trip on one another unnecessarily. Rather, today I'd like us to talk about healing rather than illness. Okay. So, I'd like us to turn to Numbers, the book of Numbers, and chapter 21. Numbers 21, verses 4 through 9, which is on the screen momentarily. Okay. So this is Moses in the wilderness, all right? And it tells about the Hebrews' journey. It says, and they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. Edom is on the east bank, the southern portion of the east bank of the Jordan River. And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. It's altogether desert country. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water. And our soul loatheth this light bread. That's the manna. No food, no water, just manna. Must be moist bread. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. You see, they knew what the problem was. We got us a terrible thing going on here. There's all these snakes, and they're biting us, and we're dying? And what could be the answer? Lord, we're desperate to know. Lord, we have to know. I mean, we're dying. My relatives are dying. My friends are dying, and it'll probably consume us all. What is it? You see, it really forced them to self-examine, to be introspective. And they came to the conclusion, we have sinned against the Lord by speaking against you who have been assigned to be an authority over us. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that every one that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it on a pole, and it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. The medical symbol is a pole that has a snake around it, remembering that event. It actually took place. There were real snakes. And what was the connection? The people self-examined and came to the conclusion it was our murmuring against Moses. That's what got us into trouble. We need to get straight with the Lord about this. So they confessed their sins. God was faithful to forgive them their sins and cleanse them of all unrighteousness if they were going to be on the straight with him. So God sets up a test. He says, okay, I want you to do a strange thing. I want you to take one of those snakes. I want you to put it on a pole, because those who will look upon the pole as an act of faithfulness, they will not die. Some people looked on the pole, and they lived. Some people said, what does that have to do with me? Can't you see? I can't look at the pole because I got to look down at the snakes, that I don't step on a snake. A snake doesn't bite me. I got to look where I'm going. I can't look up because I need to keep my eye on what's going on down here with all these snakes. If I look up, I may get bitten. Things may go badly for me if I divert my attention. If I don't bear down on being careful, I can't. You look up, not me. Some people lived, some people died. This was a, isn't it interesting that we have a connection between something spiritual, their attitude towards God, their attitudes towards Moses, and complaining and murmuring. He's no good. He's on a pride trip. He takes too much authority upon himself. He really has a bad case of self-aggrandizement. Huh? And he's going to tell us how to live. You know, he's not a perfect man either. I mean, wasn't he the guy that killed the Egyptian overseer? Yeah. He's not a perfect man. Who is he to tell us? Huh? Now, you know, familiarity breeds contempt. They had contempt for him because they had become familiar with him, and they were disgusted with, what kind of leaders are you? You have led us out into the wilderness. There's no food. There's no water. All we got is this manna, and I am sick and tired of the manna. If you're a real leader, you should be able to lead us to a place where there's some real food. I haven't had real food in decades. Yeah. So, Moses, you know, I mean, are we sure we want him to continue as our leader? Not hard to imagine. Because they had run into distress and were questioning Moses' authority. Moses was God's representative in that situation. And they were questioning Moses, and in doing so, they were questioning God, really. Did God really appoint him to be the leader? Right now it seems clear, but back then they questioned the whole thing. So there was a connection between the spiritual malady of not respecting the authority of Moses, the assigned authority, the belief that God had vested in him godly authority. But so there was, that was a spiritual problem, the murmuring. But it had a physical manifestation with the snakes. So there was a connection. Now, there's not always a connection between the reason for somebody having a physical malady is not always spiritual. You know, it could be for the glory of God, like the blind man. It could be for a variety of other reasons. You know, maybe you're not eating your Wheaties every day. There can be a lot of different reasons. Part of which may be to have a testimony of healing, like the blind man did. So we want to be careful that not all illnesses are like diseases that manifest themselves because of a spiritual malady. But it can be from that, as it was in this instance. You know, last week we spoke about the negative of a photograph. And those of you who were here, we were comparing the first Adam and the second Adam. And the first Adam was a physical, material person who left the Garden of Eden and who sinned, and we compared it with the second Adam, Ben-Adam, mentioned through in various places in the New Covenant, and the similarities. You know, the one had a rib taken out, the other had a rib put in, one took off a crown, one put on a crown. You know, there were very born of a virgin, and we went through all those last week to show that there was first there was the physical material, and then there was the spiritual. First was the counterfeit. First was the material, and then we have the outlines, as in the negative of a photograph, and then you have the positive. And that applies in our lives, our personal lives as well. Now here we have something which it would seem as though here we have also a reflection. We have the physical material situation of a snake representing sin was put on a stake, and it, if you looked upon it, you would be saved. Isn't that interesting and parallel with Yeshua being put on a stake? And those who would look upon him whom we have pierced, they would be saved, and if you would look up at Yeshua and not down at the snakes, all right, that they wouldn't bite you and you would live. So there is this parallel between what was going on a physical level and that which goes on a spiritual level. That there is spiritual healing coming from looking upon him who is on the stake, which was called, we call the cross. So there is this parallel, and it kind of tells us something. You know, why did this happen? Well, it happened so that we who have perspective can see, ah, that's how it works on a physical level. Now, if I get in, God has that on a physical level. What is its spiritual counterpart? Let's find out. Its spiritual counterpart, comes in, I'm going to skip ahead here to Isaiah 53:5. Isaiah 53:5 says that by his stripes we are healed. You know, there is another translation of that. It says, by his fellowship we are healed. You can translate that either way. You can say, by his stripes we are healed. And that's the common translation. But it's also legitimate to say that by fellowshipping with him, we are healed. Now, I like that much better, because by his stripes we are healed. I'm sure that's true, that when we think back and we just bring up to our recollection, oh, that's what it looks like, you know, on television when somebody being whipped. Yeah, that's true. Yes, and he did suffer on my behalf. Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, I've seen that picture 100 times. You know, and it has validity. But I like this other explanation more. I like it better. Because it says by his that in fellowshipping with him we are healed. boy, do I like that better. First of all, it's active. It's going on. It's something I can do about my own situation. By His stripes, I'm passive. I'm looking back on a historical event, and so what? What does it do for me? But by fellowshipping with Him, it makes sense to me. It makes sense to me that there is a healing process by being in fellowship with the Messiah. That makes sense. It's something I can do about my situation, and it says we are healed. Okay, that's present tense. It's active. It's going. Now, I say, well, okay, that's good. That's good. But how did I find myself in this situation? Proverbs 4:20 says, "My son, attend to my words; incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes; keep them in the midst of thy heart, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh." So here it is. It says that if I'll attend to God's word and I'll keep them in my heart. In other words, I can't be reading all the time. But you know how spiritual things creep into your mind all during the week? Okay. It says that those things, that dwelling in and focusing on the word of God, it says this is life. This is the source of life. It's the word was the source of everything created. So everything that lives came to life through God's word. So if we dwell on the word, if we're digesting the word, okay, that it is health to all their flesh. So there it is. It says that all right, I'm in this demented physical curse from the Garden of Eden, but if I will dwell on the word of God and the meanings of in between times, okay, it will be health to my flesh. All right, that's a promise. Okay, how did I get myself into this? Psalms 41:4 says I got into it through sin. Sin took us out of the Garden of Eden, and we began to degenerate. Huh? We started off with spiritual sin. All right, our spirit man, if you will, okay, departed from God. And what did that do? As we became more and more separated from God, we began to rely more on our intellect and emotions. And so what happened was our minds began to degenerate too. We couldn't get a sense of direction from God anymore because the channel was clogged with sin. So we began to rely on our own self-will, our own self-effort. And our minds got way from God and into defect, and we became degenerated mentality. And what did that do? Well, we were beginning to think unwholesome thoughts. And as we began to think unwholesome thoughts, we began to have unwholesome emotions. And out of the unwholesome emotions, there were secretions, poisonous secretions that came into our bloodstream and into our lymph and circulated in our muscles and throughout our bodies. And there's just so much that our bodies can take of poisons. And the poisons came not only from the food we ate, because we had a disregard for what God's instructions were, so the food took its toll also on our physicality, but also these negative secretions that came from sin. I mean, if you hate somebody, there's a poison in it that's getting into your bloodstream. All right, so it starts with a spiritual malady. It worked its way down into our intellect and emotions, and eventually it just wore out some of those cells in various parts of our body. And we've been living with this lousy situation ever since. But God had a remedy. He was not going to be overruled by His enemy, the serpent, the snake, the devil, Lucifer. He was not going to be overtaken. There would be no victory for him. So God set about that He was going to undo the damage done by Lucifer to His most noble creation, and He was going to set us back on track to reverse the entire situation. So we're in the process of a reverse situation whereby our physicality is being restored, huh? And by being in the Word of God, by being in fellowship, by praying, by singing songs, by dwelling with the Lord, you know, we're having regenerated minds. And what happens is the whole reversal is we're spiritually getting more and more attuned to God. Our intuition is sharpened up. We feel like somehow God makes his will known to us. And each of us has an individual way, but God makes himself understandable to us in a way that's understandable to us. Okay, process has been underway. Have you noticed how God uses science? You know, like there's some sort of separation between the Bible and science. God uses science in this reversal of the process. Have we not noticed that, you know, 70? That's what you get. But notice here, right now, it seems as though we're in the midst of a process where it's going back. Earlier in the Bible, okay, what was authorized was 120 years. Then it was reduced to 70 years. It seems as though we're on our way back to a longevity, an expected longevity of 120 years. We're in the midst of that process where mankind is going to commonly live to be 100. Instead of 70 being, you know, kind of a ceiling, we're going to have a new ceiling. Physically, we're being restored. And believe it or not, as there get to be more and more believers, we're being mentally, emotionally restored and spiritually restored. We're on our way back. Now, that's the big picture of what's going on. But sin got us into it. So what will do that is the undoing of sin will put us back. Jeremiah 3:22 says, "Well, yeah, I'm supposed to. I know about the stripes, and I know about the fellowship, and I know about this and that, but I just don't feel like it. Hasn't been working for me lately. I'm going to just allow myself to backslide for a while." And want to be honest about it. We've all gone through periods where we just haven't been really on the ball spiritually. But what's the solution for all of this? The solution has to do with looking upon him whom we have pierced by fellowshipping with him. So to fellowship with him, if I will fellowship with him, I am taking spiritual injections. It's just like having a physical injection. I need a regular dose of spiritual injections. And if I don't get my spiritual injections, all right, I will suffer for it. Some people have problems with their sugar. They need regular injections every day, diabetes. We who are the believers, we need spiritual injections. And what happens is, if we do not get our regular spiritual injections, what happens is we have a hissy fit. God doesn't love me. You don't love me either. But when we are involved with Yeshua, well, I can't be involved all the time because I can't be reading my Bible at work. They'll be upset. Yeah, but we can hang out with the believers. So let's say I'm not doing well. Let's say I'm not doing well at all. And now, but I want to feel better. But I'm discouraged. And I'm kind of depressed. And things are not going my way. I don't know that God loves me today. And we get ourselves into a funk. And if I will concentrate on my funk, I'll just dwell on it a little bit. My funk will get deeper. And then I really won't feel like getting into God's Word. I really won't feel like praising the Lord. I'm not going to feel like doing anything. I'm sure not going to look upon him whom we have. I just don't want to do that. I want to do something else right now. I'm not in the mood for that. And you know what? The more we do that, the less we're going to feel like in the mood. And what's going to reverse that? I'll tell you one thing. I can look at Jerry Cohen. Yeah? And look in his eyes. And he's in the spirit. And now there's a war going on between me and him. He's in the spirit and I am not. And now what's going to happen? Which spirit is going to prevail? Well, it's already been decided which spirit's going to prevail. It's going to be the Holy Spirit is going to prevail. When there is a clash, that was tested. That was tested at Calvary, which is the stronger spirit. So when there is a conflict, when there's a confrontation between the spirit that is behind Jerry, which is the Holy Spirit. He's in the Spirit versus me. I'm in the negative spirit. All right? Already been proven who's going to win. So Jerry, whether he articulates the words or not, what he's really saying is, look into my eyes. Okay? Look into the windows in my soul. Okay? And drink of the milk of human kindness. And he can pull me out of my funk by sensing his love. That works. My kids, you know, when they were little, and even today, not so much today. when they would have a problem, when they were depressed, huh? When so and so did so and so, and they didn't like it, and they're miserable, and I would say, look in my eyes. And I would make them look in my eyes, and I would say, drink of the milk of human kindness. And then they break out in a smile, okay, and that would prevail, and it would pull them out of it. Folks, we have that capacity to pull one another out of our spiritual funk, if it gets to be that bad. But there's just a lot of times that we're just not thinking spiritually. We're so much concentrated on that I don't get bitten by the snakes, that I look down to avoid the snakes, and I'm not looking up at the sin. Yeshua was made sin for us, hanging on the pole. That's it. I have to have faith enough to realize that I got to look up at Yeshua and focus on him, and that will be the solution to my snake problem. So you say, well, I don't know if I can do that. Can I spare the eye attention? Can I spare? I need to pay attention to my daily concerns because the world is out there biting me on the ankles. And I'm dying out here. I'm depressed. I'm lonely. It's not working out for me. Nothing works well. Nothing's going my way. And they're biting me. And I'm dying here. Huh? And there's just no way out for me. Oh, yes, there is. And the way out is by fellowshipping with him. Okay? I am healed. Now, what kind of healing do I have? I have a healing of all aspects of my being. And there are three aspects of my being. There is the spirit man. There is my soul. I have a three-story house. Some people say there's body and soul. Not me. I got a three-story house. I got body, soul, and spirit. And the spirit is roughly my intuitive sense. That's my spirit communes or communicates with the Holy Spirit. So as originally created, the Holy Spirit that knows what he's doing. He created everything. And he loves to commune and to communicate with me. Huh? And so long as I'm in good shape with him, I get my sense of direction. I know where I'm going on. I have my peace. And with that, now it comes as originally created into my soul, my intellect, my emotions. And that tells me how to implement the direction I was given by the Holy Spirit. And then my computer, my rationale, my rational being has decided to do this that God has suggested or recommended. Or even commanded. And now my mind structures my body with arms and legs to carry it out. That's how it's supposed to work. And that's how it does work with the believers. That's what's happening, is we're increasingly restored to our original setup. Now let's say that I become a bad boy. It happens, you know. I say the wrong thing. I do the wrong thing. I'm feeling badly about it. You know, God says, well, if you're faithful and just, I'm faithful and just, I'm going to forgive your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. That's important for us. That's a benefit to us because that clears the channel. I want to get better instructions, clearer instructions from God. I got to have a clearer channel, more clear channel, more clarity in my understanding. I want revelations. Let's get that channel clear. Let's confess our sins. Huh? And God promises that will clear the channel, we'll get better and clearer instructions that can translate into our mental apparatus, that can translate into our physical carrying out of God's will. That's how it works. So you say, well, okay. What about this thing about looking upon him whom we have pierced? What about this sin problem? I want to make a distinction. You know, the first five commandments of the Big Ten had to do with sins against God. Huh? Those are vertical. They're like the cross, anchored in the ground, and those are vertical. And you know what? I can, in my vertical understanding with God, I can mess up. And that's called a sin. It's a sin, it's a spiritual sin. And that can create a spiritual disease, a spiritual malady. And then there's the horizontal, which has to do with the sin towards my brothers and sisters, to other human beings. Jewish people can't relate to the cross. Well, I'm telling you, here's a helpful hint. I know that people wear a cross to show I'm a believer and so on, but I'll tell you, it's an anathema to the Jewish people. If you're interested in Jewish people becoming believers in a new covenant, I suggest you not wear a cross. Because what that says is, there's you and me, and we're separate, and never the twain shall meet, and I resent the cross, and I resent, it's a symbol of everything that's gone wrong for the Jewish people, and you're announcing your separateness from me. Don't tell me you love me when you're wearing a cross. That's what it means to Jewish people. So, you notice in the Messianic movement, we're fond of the concept of the cross, dying to self, crucifixion, the crucified life, the concept of the cross, but the symbol is an anathema to the Jewish people. So, I don't wear a cross. I love the concept of the cross, the vertical and the horizontal. The second five commandments have to do with sins against my brothers. Okay. Now, when those are emotional things, now, we can have sins against God. We can have sins on a horizontal level with our brothers and sisters in the Lord. Okay. Now, how do I deal with those? If I will pray to God, I mean, there's such a thing as having a spiritual disease. And there's such a thing as having a physical disease. And there's such a thing as having an emotional disease. And they're kind of the same thing, but they're kind of separate. So what's a spiritual disease? The people who were going against Moses, God's representative, that was a spiritual malady. They needed to repent of the spiritual malady. That was their problem. They were not in touch with God until they confessed of their spiritual malady of going against Moses. That is a spiritual sin. But suppose I go and I do something bad against Ronnie, God forbid. Okay? Somehow or other, that's a sin against my fellow man. And so should it be surprising that I could have an emotional problem that needs curing? Or suppose I do physical damage to somebody else. So there's the three aspects of a human being, but it's really all the same thing, that all three parts of us can undergo spiritual healing by looking upon him whom we have pierced. All right? So by fellowship, we cure disease, mental disease, spiritual disease, physical disease. Well, Paul, you know, it's all great in theory. But how can you expect me to remember that at all times? Yes, yes, I know. I'm supposed to do that. But God promises that he's going to bind us up. Let's turn to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering the sight of the blind, to set at liberty them which are bruised. That's a quotation from Isaiah 61 that Yeshua says. But notice it says all the things he's talking about. He says he's going to heal the brokenhearted. And he's going to be delivered. He's going to preach deliverance to the captives. The captives are the people who are in bondage. What are they in bondage to? They're in bondage to their sin. What about the brokenheartedness? They're talking about an emotional problem. And what about the blind? That happens to be the blind that cannot see spiritual things. They can't see spiritual things because their spirit man has yet to confess that Yeshua is the Messiah. If there is a healing that needs to take place, we can take a look and say, is this a spiritual healing, a physical healing, or emotional healing? They're all the same. All need the same cure. All of which we got ourselves into this mess by deviating from God. So what's the way back? The way back is the reversal. And that is to see that the price was paid. Why does looking up at the cross and Yeshua there on our behalf, why is that curative? Why is it curative? Oh, okay, I see the photo. Yeah, okay. I see it. It's hanging all over the place. Because what it's saying is, on a deeply subconscious level, is to say the price has been paid. You see, we have these spiritual maladies because we feel we deserve to be afflicted. On an unconscious level, we somehow understand that we have sinned, or that there's an owing, possibly from previous generations, but there's an owing in the situation. But by fellowshipping with Him, by focusing on Him, it's all the time seeping into our consciousness, sifting through our consciousness, that the price has been paid, that we are acceptable, that God sees us as acceptable, and that the rest of it doesn't count. So let's say that the day's coming, and it's coming soon, that we're all going to meet our Maker. We're all, you know, the people who are believers and who are born again, we're going to face that time. It's coming to all of us. And whatever it is, we're going to say, what about this? And what about that? And you did thus and so. And Yeshua is going to be standing there saying, paid. Well, what about that traffic fine? Paid. Everything, anything that the devil can point to that you did wrong, Yeshua, our advocate, is going to say, paid. Paid in full. When we are fellowshipping with Him, we are into that. It seems real to us that the price has been paid. Because inwardly we feel that the price has been paid, that's what gives us the recuperative power. We're no longer self-condemning. God doesn't condemn us. We're not condemning. We're not self-condemning. And that's key to our healing. The healing process is underway by fellowshipping with Him. Now, we can accelerate our healing. We can accelerate our healing by focusing on Him, by focusing on the fact that the price has been paid, by focusing on the fact that He has done this for our benefit, and we can get those regular injections. My friends, we have found ourselves in this life situation. Close as we can remember, we just got ourselves, we were born, we did the best we could, we somehow wanted to be somebody. We wanted to prove our effectiveness, our competence, show off to our parents. And we're 10 years old, and we're 20 years old, and we're still into that pride of life. Oh, look at me. Look at my potential. Look what I'm going to turn out to be. And as we get older, okay, it takes on a little different dimension. How am I doing as compared with the other people? And so there's a competition. But as we get older, it takes on a different dimension. We start looking, how did I do? Who was I? What was I? And that's when it counts, especially. That's when we have to say, well, I accepted my assignment. I did as best I could, and I submit myself to you. I have nothing to say in my defense except I plead the blood of atonement. I plead the blood of the Lamb. I plead that he has paid the price, that I am no longer guilty in the sight of God. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. The devil says I'm guilty. He can cite again and again all the different misdemeanors and high crimes that I have committed. And he's only too glad to do that. And he can get into my head and begin to cite them to me. You did this, and you shouldn't have said that. I wish you had. What do I think about that? And he can just keep, he can lay it on more and more and more. And he begins to shovel condemnation on me. And that's his job, shoveling condemnation on you and me. Just shoveling. And it becomes a heavy load of condemnation, of self-judgment, that whereby we come to think of ourselves as lousy. And that's what he wants us to do, is to feel that we are lousy and undeserving. And he just will keep doing that and keep doing that. And that's why a lot of people don't become believers, because they say, I'm not worthy. I can't do it. I can't lead that life. It's too much for me. It's too heavy. So Yeshua says, well, my yoke is easy. My burden is light. He says, wait a minute. Yeah. You were under condemnation. You did do the wrong thing. That was a correct thing. You didn't measure up. You didn't measure up. Oh, yeah. And I saw, yeah, you went to church, but, you know, you weren't reading the Bible enough. You weren't praying enough. You weren't tithing enough. Why, you lousy person. And so all of our lives, the enemy of our soul has been shoveling condemnation on our shoulders every day, every hour, more and more. And the more we indulge it, the more the bigger shovel he gets. And so a lot of people are going through their entire lives being shoveled upon, okay, with this condemnation. And I don't deserve. It can't be that simple, but it is. And so along comes Yeshua, and he says, whoa. Wait just a minute. The original problem was disobedience. That was the original problem. Everything that came from it came from the original disobedience. We had lousy parents because they had lousy parents, and they had defective parents dating all the way back. So these were all derivative sins. Every sin that you have, every sin that your parents had, were all derivative from the first crime. If the first crime can be remedied, can be reversed, now we're setting the process in reverse. And just like we started with one crime and waxed worse and worse from generation to generation, so it is that the human species is on its way home. That it starts with one man, just like it started with the first Adam. The second Adam says, okay, here's where we're going to reverse the whole thing. And he starts off with one man. And those who say, this is it. He did it. This must be the Son of God. I'm going all the way. I'm going to take my chance. I'm going to gamble on him. He knew what he was doing. And I saw him resurrected. That's proof of the fact that he really is who he says he is. And I'm going to bet my life on that. And that spread to other people, who it spread to other people. And the process on the way of going home is well underway. And we're part of that process from generation to generation. And just like those apostles, they had their role to play in the original multiplication. So it is we have a role to play in the multiplication also of his kingdom, expanding, of which there will be no end. And so it is that we're on our way back. Why? Because the original crime was solved. The penalty was paid. God decided, in his nobleness, the purity of righteousness, to say, they did it. I knew they were going to do it. They succumbed. I gave them free will, and sure enough, but I'm not going to let the devil have his way with them. I am going to have a solution. And in my righteousness, God says, I will pay the penalty. I will pay the penalty. I will suffer. I will take the penalty as though that was my only kid. Because I'll tell you something, if you had six kids, would you give your life? As I said last week, yes, you would. But suppose it was just for one kid. Would you give your life for one kid? Yes, you would. So it would be 1,000, 10, 1, all the same. It is that he came so that the original crime could be reversed. And once that's reversed, so long as we hide ourselves in that reversal, remembering in one way or another that this transaction did take place at some point in time, and it was for our good. It was for our reversal back to our original situation. Our original situation was to be blessed by God, in charge of everything on the face of the earth, clear communications with God, okay, and unafflicted by the devil. That's what we're on our way to. So you say, well, you're 75 years old, Paul. Maybe you got another 15 or 20 years by the grace of God. All right, it's still very soon. It's going to happen very soon. And when it happens, what is it? It's nothing. The spirits, the physical maladies, we're decaying anyhow, some faster than others. What is it? So, all right, in the long run, the 70 years or more by extra strength, what does it really mean? It's a temporary solution. It's a temporary problem and a temporary solution. The only thing that really counts in the long run is the spiritual maladies cured. But we're called to blessing on all three levels. And on all three levels, there was a price paid that we should be able to come back to our original condition. The Garden of Eden was created by us. It was to be a place of blessing, a place where mankind had dominion over everything else. And that is what we are returning to. We are going to have full measure. You say, well, I don't know if in the next few years I pass away. Yeah, your body will follow eventually. But it doesn't make any difference whether you're in the flesh or beyond the flesh into the next life. You're going back to the Garden of Eden. What's more, you are not going back and living in a cloister. So what's happened, you know, in Revelation, it talks about the 1,000-year millennium. The 1,000-year millennium, there's going to be coming back the devil. So let's trace through the big picture. Yeshua comes back, finally secures his throne on earth. Now there's 1,000 years of peace. That's the peace process. And it's a process. It's not like in one day everything's going to happen. It's going to happen over a period of 1,000 years. And mankind will become more and more purified in the faith, with greater and greater faith. And what will happen is at the end of the 1,000 years, the devil is going to attempt to make a comeback. And he's going to try the same thing again. And he's going to try it on human beings again. And he's going to attempt, and he's going to deceive, and he's going to falsely promise. And we're going to be tested. And this time, we're going to be wise to him, because we're going to know our Bible really well. And we are not going to succumb to it. And therefore, this time, we will rebuff the temptation. This time, he will be overcome by mankind. And now, he's finished forever. There is no coming back. He failed. He failed to deceive again. Mankind showed itself to be stronger than the fiery serpent. We will have shown ourselves to be morally superior. He will give it everything he's got in the way of deception. But at the end of the 1,000 years, mankind will not be in cloistered innocence. No, we're going to know what's cooking, and we're going to say, no, thank you. And he will have made his best try, and now he's finished. Now he's finished for good, and graphically, he's under our feet. He's in the lake of fire, in the center of the earth, and I believe that's an actual physical place. There is a hot spot. It's hot, hot, hot. And that's where he's going to live forever, and beneath our feet. And now mankind will have everything that we originally had in the Garden of Eden. Huh? But we're going to have more. What's more? We're going to have charge over all the angels. In the beginning, we did not have charge over the angels. The angels had charge over us. The devil is of the angel class. We were made a little lower than the angels. That was our station. But now, in the long run, when at the end of the 1,000 years we overcome the devil, yes, then we will be in charge of all of the angels, including the negative angels. You see, God didn't take power away from the angels. He just allowed our phylum, the human phylum, to come and be superior to the angels. Therefore, we will have authority over the angels because we did something they couldn't do. We ran the gauntlet of life. We ran the gauntlet of faith. And so that's what we're doing now. We're involved in a long-term, long-range process of little by little by little, inch by inch by inch, defeating. We are the troops. We are the ones who are on the firing line. We were brought into existence to perform our soldier's duty, to inch by inch, person by person, to take back inch by inch that territory. And we're doing our job, and we all have our assignment. And that's what's going on, is that's what your life is about. You were born into the, you were born again into this life for that purpose, to overcome evil, inch by inch, day by day, deed by deed. And when the day comes that our 70 or more by extra strength happens, whenever it is, and some people get time off for good behavior. And when that day comes, we will have done our job. Good and faithful soldier. You soldiered on. No matter what, you did it. You did your job. You stayed with it. You stuck it out. And we are part of a long line of soldiers going back who have paid the price and gone year by year, century by century, and the devil has been giving back ground, and he is real upset about it. He is real angry about it. And you can see it. You can see the anger and the frustration of our society. Everything's getting to be, the stakes are going up because it's getting closer and closer to the end. That's what our lives are about. Our lives, like David, like Solomon, like Moses, like Gideon, like all the heroes of the faith. Theirs got recorded, and we read about their exploits. Daniel says we will do exploits, and we are doing exploits. Only thing is theirs are written down. But then again, so are ours. Our exploits are written down, every one of them, in the Lamb's Book of Life. And just like we read, we will read about Yeshua and the New Testament followers. You know, they had their exploits, and they're written down. But in the Lamb's Book of Life, every single life of every single believer is in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the deeds that we were confronted with, and the temptations we were confronted with, and the things we overcame, we are going to be able to read that. In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, it talks about the heroes of the faith. It's not going to be limited to Hebrews 11. There's going to be a Lamb's Book of Life that we will be able to read for all of eternity. And I will be able to read every one of your stories. And you're going to read mine too. And we're going to feel gratified to be able to read what each of us did. Because in truth, though it is not recognized, each one of us who's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, we are a hero of the faith. We're trudging on through day by day, week by week, year by year. And according from God's perspective, we are heroes of the faith. We are in that chapter of Hebrews 11. That all, every, in Hebrews 10, it says, is God so unfaithful as to forget every one of our good deeds? No, he's not unfaithful. He does remember, and he does record, and it is down, and we will all be able to read about the heroic activities. And you say, me, a hero? From God, to me, you may not be a hero. And to you may not be a hero, but from God's point of view, you went all the way with him. You gambled everything on him. You are a hero of the faith. That's us. So God's taken back the territory, and he's taking us defective human beings to take back the territory, all done through faith. The cumulative faith, recorded in the Bible, has brought us this far. There's a long way to go. But I tell you, with the time remaining, what better thing can I do? What better thing can you do for our long-term destiny but to be a good soldier and await the recording in the Lamb's Book of Life of what we did and why we did it
and why our whole lives, even though we felt like we were stumbling, why our whole lives actually were all for the glory of God. He brought it all about. We were not born to be a mistake. We were not born again to be a mistake. No, God had from the beginning, when he gave us spiritual life, he had a journey for us. And the journey was going to be what's already written. Once we said, I am throwing in with God, I accept the blood of atonement, we're written in the Lamb's book of life. And our destiny has already been written. Already been written. The reason why we were born into this life has already been written. The remaining events have already been written. And if you mess up, that's okay. I think God may do some editing. But you're going to be in the Lamb's Book of Life with a great testimony. And we're going to be able to marvel. It didn't seem like much of a person to me. But I'm going to learn what each and every one of you did. And you know what? It's going to take me eternity. Take me forever to learn all the stories. Let's close in a word of prayer. Lord in heaven, we do look forward to being in heavenly places and to be able to meet personally with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, Solomon, Gideon, Joshua, etc., and to comb over the details of their exploits. And they're watching right now in a cloud of witnesses, seeing our exploits. And we're going to hear testimonies that build us up always higher and higher. And each of us is going to realize that we are getting higher and higher, and that the increase of our blessed spiritual place is only going to increase with increased joy, increased spirit, increase in every way. It will never stop to increase, and we'll hardly be able to stand it. So we'll just thank you that we have this interlude with you today. We ask that you would be on our minds increasingly, and that we would yield ourselves to fellowshipping with you, looking upon you, focusing on what you've done, for that will be the curing of our ills, physical, spiritually. And we thank you for this time together in Yeshua's name. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, Jerry, you want to call Jerry Cohen to come forward and to lead us in Adon Olam.
Okay. Oh, it's already here. Here we go. Ain't Eloheinu, ain't Kadoneinu, ain't Kemalkeinu, ain't Kamoshienu, mi Eloheinu, mi Kadoneinu, mi Kemalkeinu, mi Kamoshienu, no del Eloheinu, no del Adoneinu, no del Malkeinu, no del Moshienu, Baruch Eloheinu, Baruch Adoneinu, Baruch Malkeinu, Baruch Moshienu, Atohu Eloheinu, Atohu Adoneinu, Atohu Malkeinu, Atohu Moshienu. There is none like our God, there is none like our Lord, there is none like our King, there's none like our Savior. Who is like our God? Who is like our Lord? Who is like our King? Who is like our Savior? Let us thank our God. Let us thank our Lord. Let us thank our King. Let us thank our Savior. Blessed is our God. Blessed is our Lord. Blessed is our King. Blessed is our Savior. It is you who is our God. It is you who is our Lord. It is you who is our King. It is you who is our Savior. Shabbat shalom, everyone.